Hello, everybody. Once again, welcome to Real Shame, a show where the two of us talk about our list of movie blind spots. My name is Andy.
Oh, and I'm Adam.
Yes, you are Adam. He's Adam. I'm Andy.
I get confused all the time.
He's the DJ. I'm the rapper. No, other way around. No,
neither. MCs.
All right. So on Monday's episode, we talked about a movie that I had not seen. It was the movie from 2000, Finding Forrester, starring Sean Connery. And Mr. Rob Brown. We both found that to be a favorable film in our eyes. Adam decided to pair that with another movie that came out in 2000, also has kind of a professor, well, not a kind of a professor character, does have a professor character, and that movie is...
Wonder Boys.
All right, so let's dive into Wonder Boys.
Wonder Boy reminds me of the Tenacious D song. Okay, during the university's annual WordFest event, Professor Grady Tripp has to deal with a pregnant mistress, his wife's leaving him, his eccentric editor, and various other issues that come from his students. What's he gonna do in Wonder Boys?
You're mad at me, aren't you? You're mad because I shot your girlfriend's dog.
It wasn't her dog, it was her husband's. Who said anything about a girlfriend? Okay, James, I wish you hadn't shot my girlfriend's dog. Even though Poe and I were not exactly what you call simpatico, that's no reason he should have taken two in the chest. I don't know. You just keep acting like a goddamn spook all the time, James.
Well, I guess that explains why all the kids in workshop hate me.
All the kids in workshop hate you because right now you are 10 times the writer any one of them will ever be.
Wonder Boys came out, like I said last episode, a month after Finding Forrester. It stars Michael Douglas as Professor Grady Tripp. It has Tobey Maguire as James Lear, Francis McDormand, Robert Downey Jr., Katie Holmes, a whole bunch of other people. It's a movie that I haven't seen before. Have you seen this?
I have.
All right. Well, since it's still your week, I'm going to let you kick it off. What'd you think of Wonder Boys before you saw it again, and what'd you think of it this time around?
So I saw Wonder Boys. Actually, I saw it. I saw a sneak preview of it back in the day. Yes, I. So I went to like a press screening of Wonder Boys.
Oh, that's cool.
I was not a member of the press, but I had friends that were members of the press, so they would always tell me whenever there were press screenings for movies. So nice. I would just go, because most of the time they didn't ask you for credentials They figured if you knew that it was going on that you were press. But if they did ask for credentials, I would just go in with my friends and I'd be like, I'm with it, and they'd be like, okay. So we all went and saw Wonder Boys. I don't remember exactly how far in advance we saw it, big whoopty, but I was excited to see the film because it's directed by Curtis Hanson and I really love LA Confidential, and this is his first film that he did. It was 3 years later, but it was his first film that he did after LA Confidential. Obviously, I didn't expect it to be like LA Confidential. I knew that it was a different type of film or whatever, but I liked it okay. I was a little bit let down by it back when I saw it then. I just expected it to be as entertaining or as good as LA Confidential.
And which is hard to do.
Yeah, I didn't feel like it was. Again, I mean, it's kind of hard to compare the two. Well, it's very hard to compare the two because they're two totally different kinds of movies. But watching it again 21 years later, I actually liked it a lot more. It's really bizarre. I'll give you that.
It is.
It's bizarre. It doesn't have... I mean, it's got a story, but it's more about just kind of what all Michael Douglas or Grady Tripp goes through. You know, he's got a weird, eccentric kind of student, played by Tobey Maguire. He's got the eccentric editor, as you mentioned, Robert Downey Jr., who's in town trying to get a look at his second book that he's been writing, which is like 2,000-something pages.
2,600-some-odd pages, yeah.
He has gotten the chancellor of the college pregnant, played by Frances McDormand, and of course she's married to John Boy, or Richard Thomas that we saw in, what's it called, Battle Beyond the Stars, or whatever, the Magnificent Seven space movie.
You remember him from It, too? It also, not it.
Yes,
too.
Yes, it also. But yeah, it's got a lot of different characters in it. But I just, it's so quirky and weird. And it's just like, what the hell is going to happen? I mean, you got a dead dog riding around in their trunk, the trunk of a car that belongs to like a Chuck Berry kind of looking guy who wants his car back and like jumps on it, puts his butt on it. And just, I mean, it's weird. There's a Marilyn Monroe jacket in there. There's just all kinds of oddball bits and pieces. Again, if you're looking for something, I think, with like a strong story, I don't know if this is your movie, but if you're just looking to spend some time with some strange characters and kind of go on like this weird adventure with them, I think you're going to dig this movie. And I, like I say, I dig it a lot more than I dug it back in 2000. What did you think about it?
So I was expecting something more along the lines of Fighting Forcer.
Oh, yeah,
no. So, I didn't watch any trailers or anything. Yeah. I try to go into the movies kind of blind, you know. Yeah. Like, for movies I don't know about, I kind of read the synopsis a little bit and try to understand, like, if it will fit. So, I mean, reading the synopsis is like, I didn't think, I'm like, okay, this seems like an interesting movie. Yeah, that's not what we got here. We didn't get anything super straightforward. I want to put it along the lines of, like, The Long Goodbye or Inherent Vice.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Like, it plays like a, you know, like one of those private detective kind of noir kind of movies more than it plays as, like, a straightforward drama.
Right.
So, I found it really bizarre. Parts of it I like and parts of it I didn't like. So, I'm kind of on the fence with it a little bit. Surprisingly, the dead dog stuff I found pretty funny. Just like how it wound up in different places and wound up in Tobey Maguire's bed. Like, I don't know why I found that funny, but I did for some reason.
Yeah.
And I like the whole, you know, like you said, the guy's car and all that kind of stuff. The Chuck Berry impersonator. I was thinking of the James Brown, I guess, is the other person.
Yeah, he kind of looks like both, either one. Yeah, take your pick.
I kind of like that stuff. One thing I think would made the movie better in my eyes is like I'm looking at this movie through the lens of a noir private detective. So I would have think it would have been interesting if you know, Michael Douglas's character wrote like a noir, like wrote a private eye novel. So like the Flight of Avalon or whatever the name of his book was like a hard-boiled detective mystery. And now he's thrust into this real life hard-boiled detective kind of story, you know. I thought it would have been a more interesting parallel than what we got, but I mean, that's just like splitting hairs and probably not what they were kind of going for. But for me, I think that would have made the movie fuller in my eyes because it would have just kind of, you know, brought all that kind of stuff full circle and could have parallels and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So yeah, I'm kind of on the fence. There's aspects of it I like that I think are kind of funny and interesting. And I did, once I caught on to what the movie was trying to do, I did find it more enjoyable. For the first, you know, little while, I'm like, what is going on? I mean, he had this split diopter thing, which was really interesting, you know, how he shot that. And then you get like thrown in the deep end with Tobey Maguire's character, James Lear, and you're like, what is this guy's, what's this kid?
Yeah, he's a strange kid.
But then once you start getting this whole cast of characters, you can get introduced to Robert Downey Jr.'s character and the date he brought to the party and all, and like the people in the party and all that kind of stuff. You get introduced to Ripped Horn's character and all that kind of stuff. You kind of understand like, oh, this is what this movie's going for. It's just kind of zany, bizarre. Let's just like hold on for the ride kind of movie, right?
Yeah, no, definitely. It definitely is a hold on for the ride kind of movie. I agree.
So yeah, it started out kind of rocky, but you know, at the end, I kind of found things I liked and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it's based off of a novel. I think the writer was Michael Chabon.
Yep.
Was the writer of the novel, and the movie changes a few things from the original novel, from what I read, especially around the ending and stuff like that. So that's interesting.
Yeah, no, I really did enjoy kind of riding around with these characters because again, yeah, you start with, they have like a party at the Chancellor's house. And that's where Tobey Maguire ends up shooting the dog. He shoots the dog because it's attacking Michael Douglas, not because he's just like a crazy person who kills animals. I'm not justifying. Yeah. He could have just dragged the dog off of it, but it's not like he just shot it for no reason. He did have a reason. Not that it's a good thing, but and so then they have to cart the dog because they don't want the Chancellor to find out.
Yeah, yeah.
So they have to cart the dog around with them in the trunk of the car for, I guess it's a couple of days or a few days. And along the way, You know, Tobey Maguire kind of bonds with Grady Tripp's character, Michael Douglas' Grady Tripp character, which is kind of nice. I mean, it's not quite Rob Brown and Sean Connery in Finding Forrester, but, you know, he starts to really kind of take a liking to the Grady Tripp character, and to the point where he doesn't want to go to his parents or grandparents or whatever the hell they are. He's just making stuff up about his life and about what happened to his family all along, because he's actually a very, very talented writer. Who Robert Downey Jr. is kind of basically trying to seduce, but also trying to publish his book.
Well, eventually trying to publish his book. Once Grady Tripp gives it the thumbs up, because he reads it.
And then you've got the car that belongs to.
Yeah, I don't like that part. I think that's really funny. I think the dog funny. I like the car part funny. Yeah. I think it's really.
And then, you know, Grady Tripp has these like fainting spells, which explain, but again, it's just another kind of added flourish to the movie that gives it. And you've got Alan Tudyk as like a stoner janitor kind of character. So there's a lot, and there's probably some other cast.
He could be the Good Will Hunting of that movie.
He could be. He's like over there solving equations and stuff.
Solving, writing the Great American Novel on the whiteboard.
He might be. But yeah, I mean, I say this is just, to me, it's a pretty fun movie. Don't expect something with a super strong story. It's just got a, you know, the little house coat that he wears when he writes, like the little pink, like, because I guess it was his wife's, Emily's, so he wears it to write it. It's just all these little kind of flourishes in the movie. I like that kind of stuff. So it was fun to me.
Yeah, I agree. Once I kind of got on board with what the movie was trying to do, I found it more enjoyable than trying to, you know, make it do what I thought it was going to be.
Right.
Whatever that means.
Yeah. No, I got you.
So we're favorable. I think you're more favorable than I am. I'm kind of still on the fence.
Yeah.
Where do the critics fall on Wonder Boys?
81% Rotten Tomatoes, 83% audience score. Roger Ebert also gave this thumbs up. He gave Finding Forrester thumbs up. Leonard Maltin a little hotter on this movie. He gave it 3 stars.
Wow.
One thing also about this movie that I like the soundtrack. It's got like some good kind of Bob Dylan songs.
As soon as they played Neil Young, I was like, Andy's going to dig this.
It's good. I do like Neil Young.
It was Old Man by Neil Young?
Old Man by Neil Young. Yeah. Yes.
It was. I thought the music was good. It was a choice. Yeah.
And I think Curtis Hanson directed the video because it uses the Bob Dylan song Things Have Changed in this movie. I think that's what plays over the opening credits. I believe Curtis Hanson also directed that video. So.
And didn't Bob Dylan get like an award for being in the movie?
I have no idea.
I think I remember reading on IMDb he did.
I don't know.
Correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, but I believe that's true.
All right.
All right. So that was our review on Wonder Boys that we found Wonderbaugh. But we always like to follow up our Wednesday episodes with some viewer questions. And since we kind of talked about a mean teacher/professor in the And Monday's episode and this episode, we got Professor Tripp. We figured, hey, why not talk about our favorite fictional, favorite movie, TV show professors and teachers and talk about which ones we like and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
So I guess you want to go first? Or you want me to go first?
I'll go first. I got a few like also rans, and then I've got probably my favorite professor of a film. So I feel like you can't talk about teachers or professors in film without talking about Edward James Olmos as Jaime Escalante. I believe that's right. In Stand and Deliver, Calculus.
I know Edward James Olmos from Battlestar Galactica. Okay. Everything else went over my
head. He plays Jaime Escalante. He was based on a true story.
Yeah.
Real life teacher in California, I believe. And like Lou Diamond Phillips is in it. But he was a calculus teacher.
Oh, cool.
And he encouraged his students. I was looking for the right word. It was like he punched his student. No, he encouraged his students.
Uppercutted them.
But no, it's a good movie and, you know, kind of a uplifting kind of story. What about you?
So, I mean, I feel like you got to look at the 600-pound elephant in the room. Is that how that goes?
Sure.
The pink elephant in the room, 600-pound gorilla. And talk about the Harry Potter movies, right? There are movies about, there's 8 movies about this boarding school for wizards and witches and stuff like that in England. So there's a bunch of professor characters there. I think the standout for me is Albus Dumbledore. I think he's cool. Do you have a favorite Harry Potter professor?
Severus Snape. played by the late, great Alan Rickman.
He does a great job.
I love Severus Snape. I love the character in the books. I love the character in the movies.
I am with you 100% on that.
He's awesome.
For sure. So, yep. Just wanted to shout out Harry Potter and on those all those professors.
Harry Potter.
I like Professor Lupin. I like McGonagall. McGonagall's awesome.
McGonagall.
Oh man, I could just... I watch Harry Potter movies every year, so I'm a fan.
Good deal.
All right.
So I took this one from a movie that we watched. This was our very first episode, right? No, our second episode.
I don't know.
Fast Times at Ridgemont High was our second, because we did Rock and Roll High School first, and then we did Fast Times at Ridgemont High second. I really like the Mr. Hand teacher in
that. He is awesome.
The Ray Walston character that actually gave Sean Penn's Spicoli character a little break there. I mean, he went to study with him or whatever.
Yeah.
He said, you know, you took up my time, now I'm going to take up your time. But he actually turned out to be a pretty cool dude. So, I don't know, I just thought of him because
he was
a teacher that we did on the show. So
I think he's great, and we were very favorable of him during the review, I remember.
Absolutely, yeah.
Stuff like that.
Yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to go with a movie that you don't like, and that
I think I know what you're going to say.
Who?
Dead Poets Society.
Yep. Professor John Keating from Dead Poets Society.
Yeah.
It's Andy does not care for the movie.
No.
And I found the movie, also watched it around, you know, finding Forrester time and all that kind of stuff. And I found the movie to be very exciting, thrilling, transcendentalism and Walt Whitman and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, Captain, my Captain.
Oh, Captain, my Captain.
I'm going to stand on my chair.
You should. During those are the books in English class that spoke to me the most. Like, of all the assigned reading that we had to do in high school and stuff like that, it was all that transcendentalism, Walt Whitman kind of stuff. I can't think of any of the authors. Otherwise, I'd say their name. Really spoke to me. So I liked that movie, and I liked that professor.
I like Peter Weir movies, but I'm not a big fan of Dead Poets Society. It's just too much for me. Too schmaltzy. I wrote down a movie from the 90s. It's a movie about a music teacher. Mr. Holland's Opus, also starring Richard Dreyfuss. We mentioned him in the last episode when I talked about Krippendorf's Tribe. But I think that's a movie that a lot of people have forgotten about.
Do you think it still holds up? Have you seen it recently?
I have not seen it. I've only seen it when it came out.
Yeah, same here.
No idea.
I remember I had a guitar teacher. I was taking guitar lessons at the time. And he was very upset that he wanted to write the Great American Symphony Mr. Holland did. And he was very upset that it was a very modern, like, it wasn't like the music he wrote, that Mr. Holland wrote, was very modern.
Mm-hmm.
Like, my guitar teacher took that as like a personal affront. Like, he felt it should have been like more classical, I guess.
Okay.
I mean, I'm remembering this from like 20 years ago, but I think that's how it went. Like, he was just, I just remember him being very upset with whatever that score, that piece of music that Mr. Holland came up with. Spoiler alert, at the end of the movie, He was very upset that it was a more modern take on music than it was traditional, I guess.
Did he write his congressman about it? What did he do in retaliation? Did he burn the theater down?
I have no clue. I don't think I continued listening.
He rented a copy of Mr. Holland's Opus and he smashed the VHS over his knee. Burnt
it.
He was like, I hate this.
Yeah.
Damn you. All right. I've only got one more.
I got one more, too.
Okay.
You want to? I got one that I don't see on your list, but I think you might want to add it to your list.
Okay.
All right, this is probably my favorite professor of all time, and that is Professor Henry Jones Jr., Professor Indiana Jones. One of my favorite movies of all time, so I had to go there, and I did, and it's awesome.
Yeah, I Indiana Jones didn't even cross my mind as a professor because I just think of him as an adventurer, an archaeologist. But yeah, no, that's an excellent. Number one, mine is probably not that cool, but this professor, he's actually kind of a dick in the movie, but probably more so kind of a dick as like Mr. Hand might be kind of construed as kind of a dick in Fast Times at Ridgemont High, but he ends up being like kind of okay.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he's hard on his students, but he's really trying to push them. But it's from a movie from the early 1970s with Timothy Bottoms called The Paper Chase. And the professor in the movie is played by John Houseman. John Houseman is portrayed in the movie Mank because he was also a movie producer. He was a movie producer slash actor. But he plays Professor Charles Kingsfield in the movie version of The Paper Chase from, I think, 1973. And then also later on, it was a short-lived kind of TV series. And he was Professor Charles Kingsfield on the television series as well. I have never watched the television series, but I think the movie is actually really good.
I don't think I've seen The Paper Chase.
It's a good movie.
Because there's a movie called Paper Moon, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a completely different
Bogdanovich, movie. Peter Bogdanovich, yeah. That's a different movie. I remember The Paper Chase was, I had an economics professor in college. His favorite movie was Fiddler on the Roof. But I remember he brought one of our class periods, he brought a VHS tape where he had recorded an episode of the Paper Chase TV show on that he wanted to show us. Huh? That had something to do with economics, I guess. I just remember awesome. The things you remember, things like that. That's one of the things I remember. But the movie Paper Chase is good, and John Houseman does a really good job as the stern, kind of mean Charles Kingsfield character.
We'll have to add it to my list. That sounds interesting.
Let's do it.
All right. That's it. That is it. If you have a favorite movie, TV show, fictional professor that we didn't talk about, leave it below. Leave us a comment below if you're watching us on YouTube, or shoot us an email. And our email address is realshame@gmail.com. We also answer viewer questions like this at that email address. So be sure to send us your viewer questions so we can put that in the bucket and answer it on air. What do I always say? We're on social media at Real Shame on Instagram. Like, subscribe, share, do all that social media stuff. It really does help, and we really do appreciate that. And stay tuned as we cross some more movies off our list of shame. I think it's going to be my week because this week was your week, so that's how it goes. We'll cross some movies off my list of shame, guys, next week, and we'll see you soon, guys. Bye.